Today we are going to discuss, to continue our discussion about seismic data processing. The topic is digital filters. Yesterday we stopped at this slide where we were considering the relation between filters and convolution, and we realized that from yesterday's lecture that filtering is in fact a convolution process, and also convolution is a filtering process. They are the same thing expressed in different domains. There are several ways to do filtering. We have infinite impulse response filters, IIR filters, like the two shown much earlier. Yesterday we saw two types of filters. These two types of filters depends on the memory. There is a feedback from the output into the output into the input again. So this is called feedback. These two examples are IIR filters. They are called IIR because the filter's impulse response continues to infinity. Yes, at an infinitely small value for a stable filter. These filters effectively use a topology that implements the history inside a few important sensitive state variables. On the other hand, there is another kind of filters called finite impulse response, which in other words, just to do the convolution using a potentially arbitrary impulse response. Now we have another question, which is, does FIR and IIR the same? The answer is no, because FIR filter have zeros and IIR filters have bools. In reality, nearly all IIR filters have both bools and zeros, which is to say that they have both FIR and IIR part, which means that the IIR filter include in its structure an FIR, AFIR filter. Another difference is that FIR and IIR filters can have quite different properties and usually do. They are two different means to an end. And now we come to important statements. Neither one nor the other is always better. So there is some situation where we can use, or where using IIR filter is peripheral or is superior, while in another occasion there is the use of FIR, for example, is peripheral. And this is one of the most important property of science. It's if we have everything, we can say a medication, for example, that can cure or disease, then we do not need doctors. If someone discover some medication to cure any disease, so why would we need doctors? We do not need doctors. So also, there is no instrument, there is no automatic procedure can be used to solve all problems. Thus, or here is your presence. It's your choice. You choose which is best and for what application. We said before bools and zeros, and we want to know what is the meaning of bools and zeros. Bools and zeros are means of representing what the so-called transfer function. A transfer function is a representation of the response of the filter. And also, we can use the transfer function to apply the filter in frequency domain. Now we have the transfer function for system. This system is composed of numerator n of function of s and denominator d function of s, which is equal k, which is a constant. This constant might be the sensitivity, might be the gain of the filter or of the system. And then the numerator is binomial tuples with s minus z1 times s minus z2 and so on till s minus zn. And the denominator is also binomials, s minus b1, s minus b2, and so on until s minus bn. Here, the z in the numerator is the zeros, which means the root of the equation of the numerator. Or, in other words, the value for the frequency that makes the numerator equal zero, or that makes h of s, the transfer function, equal zero. Bools, on the other hand, is the value or the root of the equation of the denominator, which makes the value of the denominator equal zero. We know division by zero is not allowed in mathematics, so at this value we have Bools, we have no value at this point. So the value is defined around this, so we call this, around this frequency, we call this bool. So using bools and zeros, we can define the transfer function of the system or of a filter. Now we have an example. We have linear system described by differential equation, second differentiation of y by partial dt square plus five dy by divided by dt plus 6y equal 2 differentiation of u with respect to t plus 1. We want to find the bool and zeros for this bools and zeros for this system, so we transform the equation into this is what is the so-called Laplace transform of the equation, and this equation now turns to be the transfer function of the system, which is equal to 2s plus 1 divided by s squared plus 5s plus 6, which means that question for you, for the numerator, what is the value of s that makes the numerator equal zero? Okay, we have 2s plus 1. So what's the value of s that makes this equal zero? Negative half. So when s equal negative half, we have zero. Okay, then we go to denominator. We have the s squared plus 5s plus 6, and we want to know the value of s that makes the denominator equal zero. So we will analytically solve this problem to find out that s equal minus 3 or s equal minus 2 would be the solution to this equation, which means that we have two bools equal to minus 3 and minus 2. Okay? Sometimes we have two identical pools. When the solution comes, for example, if we are working of end up with, for example, S minus 3 and S minus 3 again. So in this case, we have two pools at the same point, and also at the same value. And also, we have to realize that the number of pools is dependent on the highest power of the equation. So if the highest power is 2, we expect to have 2 pools. If the highest power is 3, we expect to have 3, and so on. So what is the definition of a transfer function? A transfer function is equivalent to the output signal or the output voltage divided by the input voltage. The transfer function describes the behavior of a circuit at output voltage or output signal for all possible input signal. Now we have an example for a circuit. Try to find the transfer function. We have the relation V out equal Vn times R2 plus R3 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3. Then by substitution, we find out that H equals 5 divided by 6. So if the input signal equal 6 volts sine 2kt plus pi divided by 2 plus 12 volt, then the output signal would be 5 volts sine 2kt plus 2 pi plus 10 volt. So I can use the transfer function either to get the input signal from the output signal or to get the output signal from the input signal. In today's lecture, we are going to discuss two types of filters. Of course, there is a lot of there are many kinds of filters, but we are going to focus our discussion about FIR filters and IIR filters. Starting by FIR filters, we are going to discuss the theory behind FIR filters and then properties of the FIR filtering, including the aliasing, and how to calculate the coefficients. Starting with the properties of an FIR filter, we have the equation that describes the FIR filters, which is y of n, which is the output signal or output voltage, equal summation from k equal 0 to n minus 1 bk times x of n minus k. In this equation, we have bk, the coefficients of the FIR filter, and we have x of n minus k as an input signal, and n represents the number of filter coefficients, which in other words defines the order of the filter. So this is the general equation of FIR filters. As you see, there is no feedback from the output signal. Now, suppose the input is the impulse response, which is a Dirac function, delta of n. Then the relation y of n summation k equals summation k from 0 to n minus 1 dk times x of n minus k will be summation from k equals 0 to n minus k bk delta times delta n minus k. And if we write the summation exclusively, we have the form b0 delta 0 plus b1 delta minus 1 and so on for the first point in the signal. Continuing our discussion for the end point, now we are going to obtain the general form yn equal b0 delta n plus b1 delta n minus 1 plus till bk delta n minus capital N. This equation, depending on the property or the definition of delta function, delta n small minus k equal 1 for n equal k. This is the definition. This is the definition of delta function. And for other points other than n equal k, which means n not equal k, the value of delta, the delta function is zero. So the multiplication here turns to single point. This single point depends on the value here, the subscript here. So if we return back to previous slide, for this explicit form, if we assume that n equals zero, okay, then we have b null delta zero plus b1 delta minus 1 and so on. For this relation, all the terms are zeros except the first one. The definition of delta function is that the delta function have the value of 1 when its subscript is zero. Okay, so when n equals zero, the function, the delta function equal one. So all other terms become zeros except the first one. Then for n equal one, the first one, which is delta one, is zero, and here delta n minus 1, which 1 minus 1, which is 0. So this term remain, and then the other terms vanish. So as you see, the value of the coefficient, the value of the coefficients is the value of y. Okay? The value of the coefficients is the value of the y in its position, meaning that when y, the first signal, the first point in the signal, so the coefficient The first coefficient equal this value. The second equal the value of the second, and so on. Which means that, as we have said, the impulse response of the filter represent the value of the coefficients. So H here is the impulse response, and here are the coefficients. So the impulse response, the series that represents the impulse response, is at the same time as the value, or is the values of the coefficient to the filter itself. In summary, we can say that B subscript K is equal to H of K, which means that the coefficients of a filter are the same as the impulse response samples of the filter. Now, turning to defining the frequency response of an FIR filter, we achieve this by taking the Z transform of the HN, the equation HN, which is the transfer function. We obtain H of Z, which is the Z transform, equal summation from Z from N equal 0 to N minus 1, H of N Z to the power minus N. Further, replacing Z by e to the power j omega, where j is the imaginary number and omega is the angular frequency. The angular frequency equals 2 pi f. Okay? So, replacing Z by e to the power j omega in order to find the frequency response, we have H of Z for Z equal e to the power j omega equal to H e of e to the power I j omega equal summation from n equal 0 to n minus 1 H of n e to the power minus j n omega. So here n is related to the power of Z and the transformation. Using the property that, or the identity that e to the power minus j 2 by k equal 1, our relation, which is h of n e to the power minus j n omega plus 2 pi will equal h of n times e to the power minus j n omega. Okay? This occurs because e to the power minus j 2 by k is equal 1. So we have the identity that H of e to the power j omega minus plus 2 k pi will equal H of e to the power j omega, which means that we have periodicity in this transfer function, and we can say that FIR filters have a periodic frequency response with period equal to 2 pi. Now we are going to have some examples about the frequency response of an FIR filter for the periodic or the periodicity of these type of filters. We have this xn as input, and as you see, we have input signal with equal amplitude for nearly all the frequency represented here in the graph. This can be regarded as the delta function. Remember, yesterday we plotted delta function here, and we described the Fourier transform of delta function to be white spectrum, and it defines that white spectrum means we have the same amplitude as a value, we can say, normal or one or unity for all frequencies. So this is the unit white spectrum, and then when introduced into the FIR filter, the output is the filtered signal, which is here, as you see, the transfer function or the impulse response or the behavior of the filter. So someone of you may tell me what is the type of this filter? This filter. Now this is the impulse, this is the unit impulse, and this is the impulse response which describes the behavior of the filter. So someone of you, if you are following today and yesterday lecture, tell me what is the type of this filter? Yes, we have how many types for filters? We have low pass filter, we have band pass filter, we have band reject filter, and we have high pass filter. Okay? And anti-alias? Yeah, okay, but I'm speaking not about anti-alias filter. I'm speaking from the categories we describe for filters. We have low pass, band reject, and high pass. This type of filter belongs to which one of them? Low pass filter. Why? Excuse me?
The output, we get the low frequency.
We have
the exponentially decay low frequency. The output was
okay. Does anybody else have another opinion? Anybody else have another opinion? I want you to not to copy information into your brain, but to think, to use your brain. So now this is the original signal, as we said, it has amplitude of the same value for all frequency. And now we end up with signal with amplitude at low frequency are kept the same. And then after certain frequency, the amplitude decay, reduced, and then vanish. So this is a low pass filter. So this one is a low pass filter. Okay?
Due to the decreasing of amplitude.
due to the reduction of the amplitude of high frequency part. Now, for this frequency, before is a low frequency, and after is a high frequency. So, what is the part of spectrum that's kept the same? It's the low frequency. Low pass, you know, low pass means that. Yes. Low pass, so suppose somebody is door guard and people are passing by him, and then he was ordered to pass persons with the length with 1.5 say tall, 1.5 meter tall. So he will put something, and then everyone who comes with little with tall less than 1.5 meter, he will pass. Taller persons will stop. Okay? So after this door, we'll find the people in the other direction with 1.5 meter tall and less. So because if one is 1.4, he will pass. 1.2 will pass. One will pass. So this is what we are going low pass means. Low pass means the lower frequency will pass with no attenuation, but the higher frequency will be rejected or will be reduced. Okay. So try to keep this in your mind. Try to keep this example, so that you can use this example if you facing or forgot this type of filters. So you remember. So this one is doing so, and this one doing so, and so on. So we can regard also sieves as filters. Yes or no?
Yes.
Sieves.
Yes.
Sieve. Sieve, not thief.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Sieves is a kind of filters. For some reason, the laptop is annoyed, so he stopped responding, and filters us out, and so we should return back to our presentation. We have five advantages for FIR filters over the IIR filters. These advantages are: they can easily be designed to be linear phase, and actually FIR filters are actually linear phase. Both simple linear phase filters delay the input signal but don't distort its phase. Generally speaking, in seismic experiment, especially the body wave experiment or body wave exploration like B-wave and S-wave, phase is not used often, because phase is related to the so-called dispersion of wave. Dispersion means that the velocity of the wave change with frequency. Thus, the wavelength also will change. Thus, the based on the frequency, the wavelet will be wider at longer distances, because at longer distances the difference between velocity becomes more visible, and thus we use the phase spectrum to define this phenomena. But in body wave spectrum, in the frequency of application, this phenomena is not present. It can be neglected, I mean. So, but this FIR filters keep the phase linear. Keeping anything linear means that you can simply add, multiply by something, linear relation, and then remove this effect to regain the original form. So, meaning we have linear phase, we are not distorting, we are keeping the phase as its original form. We are not distorting the phase. So in some application, this is superior and this is important and needed. Second, they are simple to implement. On most DSP, which digital signal processing microprocessors, the FIR calculation can be done by looping a single instruction. So you can use an equation, and you put this equation or definition, mathematical definition, and you put this definition in a loop, like for or while. You studied computer language, like C or Java, MATLAB. So you put into a loop, then you can obtain the effect, or you can design the FIR filters. Third, they are suited to multi-rate applications. By multi-rate, we mean either decimation, which is reducing the sample rate. Sometimes we need to reduce the sample rate to meet the memory we have in our machine. So, for example, in AMALI experiment, in the second level, you, in common practice, you decimate the trace so that it meets the ability or the memory available on the machine. So we can reduce the sample rate, we can interpolate, which means increasing the sample rate, or both. Whether decimation or interpolating, whether decimating or interpolating, the use of FIR filters allow some of the calculation to be omitted, thus providing an important computational efficiency. This is in contrast with FIR filters. Each output must be individually calculated, even if it's that that output while when discarded, so the feedback will be incorporated into the filter. We mean that for IIR filter, we need to estimate all values in IIR filter, because we use feedback. So the output is used as feedback. Again, it is returned back to the filter. So the estimation should be done, and nothing is omitted, because if we omit something, we will end up with a distorted signal or unrealistic filtered signal. Fourth, they have desirable numeric properties. In practice, all DSP filters must be implemented using finite precision arithmetic, that is, a limited number of bits, which means the use of finite precision arithmetic in IIR filter can cause significant problem due to the use of feedback. But for FIR filters without feedback can usually be implemented using fewer bits, and the designer has fewer practical problem to solve related to non-ideal arithmetic. This is related to the number of bits we have. Suppose you have a calculator, and this calculator is, say, 8 decimal places. So If you provide the calculator with a number with more than 8 decimal places, what will happen? What will happen?
It will stop at
8
decimal places.
Yes. So it will do either according to the manufacturer of the calculator. To do what's called chopping, like your colleague said, it will cut all values after the 8th decimal place, or it will round the number. So if the later numbers are greater than 0.5 or 5 for that place, it will be added to 1 to the last 8th decimal place, and so on. All this cause errors. All this round error, round of error, chopping error, all this put error on our calculation. So you have in FIR filters, as the output is not related directly to the filter itself, there is no feedback. So this problem will not affect the way the filter work. But for IIR filters, we have to use high precision, and then if we are going to use signals that does not meet the conditions of our filter, we have to redefine the filter to meet the decimation or the decimal places or the accuracy of that signal. Finally, they can be implemented using fractional arithmetic, unlike IIR filters. It is always possible to implement FIR filter using coefficients with magnitude of less than 1. The overall gain of the FIR filter can be adjusted at its output if desired, and this is an important consideration when using fixed point DSPs, because it makes the implementation much simpler. Okay? Thank you. Meet you tomorrow, inshallah. Bye.